Right now, I want to bring in one of President Trump's top economic advisors, Kevin Hassett. Kevin, I know that the White House, I think it's pretty brilliant, by the way, on your part and the White House's part, to acknowledge that there's an anti-capitalism move going on. And so you've prepared a report, or the White House has prepared a report on socialism. And you want to share some of those with us as we approach the 200th anniversary of Karl Marx's birth.
Yeah, sure. You know, we put a report out today that has received a heck of a lot of attention already. And basically, one of the things that we noticed at the Council of Economic Advisors as a bunch of geeky economists is that there are a lot of people, you know, they're bandying about the word socialists that maybe don't even understand what that word means. And so, you know, we haven't put out a political document, but rather an academic one that goes through the history of socialism and really how terrible it's been for the people who have adopted it. And then we talk about even things like the modern Nordic examples and give some fun facts or not so fun facts. Like, for example, if you take a typical Scandinavian and move him to the U.S., then his income goes up by 50%. And it's a metric of how much better our policies are than the more socialist ones of Scandinavia.
Well, I love and appreciate that it's an economic document. But when you start talking about Nordic countries, you are, in fact, heading off at the pass, the political argument that's being made. First, when they started talking socialism, it seemed crazy, the trail of destruction, economic and human lives, by the way, in the path of the socialism. Sure. So the Democrats like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez have altered their message, and they've said, well, it works for the Nordic countries. And so you're saying, no, even there, it's a bad policy compared to what we have in America.
Sure, that's correct, too. And I think that also that a lot of the modern people or modern socialists in America who refer to Nordic countries don't actually understand what policies are going on in Nordic countries. So, for example, in Nordic countries, people actually have to pay when they show up for health care and so on. And so what we do with the paper is we compare Nordic countries of today to Nordic countries of the 70s, where they really were much more like pure socialist countries. And we show that by relaxing their socialist policies, the Nordic economies basically started to boom, which, again, kind of proves the points. And so you could look at the history of socialism, and of course most socialist nations just fail, but even the ones like the Nordic countries in the 70s that embrace socialism wholeheartedly have relaxed those policies now if they're still out there.
Yeah, sort of like that Finland experiment of not paying people without any strings attached.
Right.
Didn't take them long to figure out, golly, this just simply isn't going to work.
And we show in the paper, just again drawing on a big literature, that if we were to adopt the typical country for the Scandinavian countries of the 70s, the typical economic policies, then our GDP would drop 19%. And that's based on a big literature. And so I think that people who advocate socialism are going to have to make a much stronger case than they've been making.
You know, Kevin, I love, by the way, this kind of stuff. One of your charts that stood out big time was the agricultural production in Cuba before and after the nationalization of farms. Mm-hmm. And you go through all of these things and you show how much they declined from a period, right from 63 to 64.
Sure.
Beef was down 45%, pork was down 84%, poultry down 36%, milk down 39%, corn down 39%, sugar down 35%, potatoes down 50%. The country wasn't even able to feed itself after they embraced socialism and nationalism.
Right,
or this kind of nationalization of farms.
But as we talk about in the paper, there was a time when Cuba and Puerto Rico had basically the same standard of living, but Puerto Rico is about double Cuba because, again, of the failure of socialism. Now, there are people who say, you know, hey, if the government takes something over, then maybe they could make your life better. And you could certainly come up with a theory where maybe that would be true. But the point we make in the paper is that we look at all the countries that have tried, and when they do, they basically make people worse off.
Before I let you go, Kevin, I've got to ask you about the market. We were off almost 600 points in the Dow. We're coming back a little bit, but how concerned is the White House, and why do you think this is happening?
Well, I think the market goes up and down every day based on, you know, any number of factors. And the fact is that the market is way up since President Trump took office. And so a normal amount of fluctuation is something that we expect. I don't think that the decline today is anything that's out of the ordinary for a normal bull market.
All right. More sellers than buyers.
Yeah.
Kevin Hassett, thank you very much.
Yeah, bye-bye. Thank you.